Hurricane Gilbert made landfall this week on Jamaica, passing the full length of the island and causing 45 deaths and an estimated $700 million in damage, but worse was to come. Growing ever stronger, it tore across the Yucatan Peninsula and into Texas and Oklahoma. It was the most intense Atlantic hurricane on record, and remains second after Hurricane Wilma in 2005, and left behind a trail of devastation, 318 dead, mostly in Mexico, and nearly $3 billion worth of damage. And around the world, eyes turned to Seoul for the opening of the 1988 Summer Olympics. Before the Games began, though, the host for the 1994 Winter Games was announced. This was the extra Games that would take place just 2 years after Albertville 1992, as the Winter Games moved to being held in between the summer ones rather than in the same year. The host for this extra Games would be Lillehammer in Norway, which was chosen ahead of Östersund, Sweden, Anchorage, Alaska, and Sofia, Bulgaria. With that done, the Seoul Games got underway. With both 1980 and 84 having been struck by political boycotts, many were worried that hosting the Games in a divided Korea might cause more friction, and indeed attempts to organise some kind of North Korean participation ended up in deadlock when the Pyongyang government insisted on a full 50-50 hosting split. But in the end, it was only North Korea and their backers Cuba who withdrew for political reasons. In all, 159 nations took part, with 8 making their debut, though Brunei only sent an official for the swimming and no actual athletes, but they got to march in the parades at least. The opening ceremony, the last to be held during the daytime, featured skydivers forming the Olympic rings above the stadium, and a release of doves to symbolise peace. Unfortunately, this was done immediately before the lighting of the Olympic flame, and several of the doves were immolated after alighting in the cauldron. The official song of the Games was Hand in Hand by Giorgio Moroder and Tom Whitlock, but for most people around the world, the Games would forever be associated with the song One Moment in Time by Whitney Houston. And with that soundtrack, we move on to Portugal, where there seemed to be a spring in everyone's step at the Estoril circuit, whether because someone had finally beaten the McLarens and the goodwill felt towards Ferrari's feel-good story, or just because the sun was out, the food and the wine were excellent and the beaches were inviting. The locals were out in force after a disappointing turnout last year. Lacking a Portuguese driver to follow, they tended to latch onto the Brazilians, and this year that meant Senna. Mansell was back in the Williams, having regrown the famous moustache, and with a bit of a sore neck, but eager to get back into the groove, while Prost was experimenting with a new stiffer chassis. But otherwise, there was very little change in the paddock from Monza, as the teams looked towards 1989 rather than continuing development on their current cars. Though March had done a little bit of testing at Vallelunga to nail down a problem with understeer at slow speeds, and appeared to have sorted it. Looking forward to next year, Andrea De Cesaris was confirmed as the second driver in an expanded Scuderia Italia team, who would still be using Dallara chassis. Michele Alboreto still had no drive for next year, and Minardi still had no designer. With Oscar Larrauri once again disposed of in pre-qualifying, the big boys took to the track, and while Senna was top of the heap as usual on Friday, times came down dramatically as the track was cleaned up and rubber laid down on Saturday. Prost went out early and set a stonking time, quicker than Berger's 1987 pole with 4-bar boost, and then changed into jeans and a t-shirt and exuded calm and confidence, while Senna fretted and fussed waiting for a clear lap. Unfortunately, Gabriele Tarquini pranged his Coloni, and the resulting clean-up took up most of the rest of the session. So Alain Prost took just his second pole of the year, with Senna second, giving McLaren their 9th front-row lockout of the year. But the real sensation was in third and fifth places, where the aqua blue marches of Capelli and Gugelmin bracketed Berger's scarlet Ferrari. Aside from the long straight, Estoril has a lot of corners and short point and squirt straights, and the slippery aerodynamics and responsive atmospheric engine were just the ticket. Mansell was sixth on his return to the cockpit, alongside the man he'll be replacing next year, Alboreto. Piquet slipped from 3rd on Friday to line up 8th, with Nannini 9th after a frustrating session for Benetton, and Warwick 10th, struggling for grip and finding the laggy Megatron turbo unsuitable for the circuit, even with its modifications. Patrese could only manage 11th, Boutsen was 13th, and the other Lotus 16th, while the Minardi cars were again looking quite good, with Martini up to 14th. Palmer put his Tyrrell on the grid 22nd ahead of both Ligiers, still running the old radiator setup after continued problems getting enough practice time to evaluate the new ones, with Lorini and Tarquini bringing up the rear end, and Bailey for the 8th time this year failing to qualify, alongside both Sack Speeds, with Eric Sikowski glumly predicting they'd be doing even worse at Jerez, and Stefano Modena giving Eurobrun their third double DNQ on the bounce. The sun was still blazing down on Sunday as the cars lined up on the grid, with temperatures north of 30 degrees Celsius, 86 Fahrenheit. Prost was fastest in the morning practice again, with Boutsen second and feeling better about the race itself. Andrea Cesaris stalled on the grid after the parade lap, so after a short break they went round again. The second time around, there was another problem as Warwick was slow away and was hit by Andrea Cesaris. Well, Nakajima and Sala were also caught up in the melee. Senna had got away best and was leading, but the race was stopped for a third attempt at the start. So, with the cars repaired and topped up to allow a full-distance race, and the teams looking nervously at their clutches, the cars got ready for a third go, and this time it all went well. Prost, now wise to Senna's plan, moved over to try and crowd him out, but it was the Brazilian that took the lead once more into turn one, with Capelli hot on Prost's heels in third, Berger holding fourth, and Mansell getting up to fifth ahead of Gugelmin. As they came round to complete the first lap, the roles were reversed. Prost pulled out, Senna tried to crowd him out, squeezing the Frenchman so close to the pit wall that March team manager Ian Phillips had to pull his pit board out of the way to avoid Prost headbutting it, and their wheels were dangerously interlocked for a second before Prost hit a bump, Senna swung over to avoid being hit, and Alain had the corner. Prost immediately began to surge away from Senna, who still had a feisty Capelli hanging onto him. And by lap four, the gap was already over 3 seconds, and Capelli was all over the back of Senna like a sweaty T-shirt. Johansson was the first casualty of the afternoon, departing from 17th with a blown Judd on lap five, but all eyes were on Senna and Capelli's scrap over second place, while Berger was edging up on them too to make it a three-way battle. Prost, meanwhile, was setting a series of fastest laps, building up as big a lead as he could, despite running on minimum boost and at lean fuel mix to minimise the risk of running dry. Behind Senna, meanwhile, Capelli had concluded that McLaren was having grip problems and began to push harder, hoping to pressure Ayrton into a mistake. In fact, Senna's fuel gauge readout was faulty and was telling him that he was burning fuel too fast and therefore he was driving cautiously to ensure he had enough to finish with. After what he described as the most frustrating qualifying he'd ever had in any formula, Chivas' turbocharger failed and he was out, followed shortly afterwards by De Cesaris, whose half shaft had gone. By lap 10, Senna led Capelli and Berger closely, with Mansell now also heaving into view, while further back Nelson Piquet in 7th led a four-car scrap, with Alboreto, Patrese and Boutsen all running tight together, and Sandro Nannini, once again charging from the back, set the fastest lap on lap 13. Prost beat it a couple of laps later, but Nannini was clearly going places. While Piquet was busy fending off Alboreto's advances, Nakajima spun into the gravel on lap 17 of the 70. Capelli, meanwhile, continued providing the best viewing as he harried and hassled Senna, who continued keeping him behind by hook or by crook. Finally, though, on lap 22, he made it through and headed off in pursuit of Prost, free from any fuel worries. Senna now had to start looking in his mirrors for Berger. The Austrian wasted no time at all with his turbo Ferrari power and bullied his way through further round the same lap, as Capelli took 2 seconds out of Prost's lead just on his first lap past Senna. With the crowd whistling and jeering his performance, Senna was now caught by Mansell, with Gugelmin not far off either. Meanwhile, incredibly, Capelli was reeling Prost in, hand over fist, making the gap just 4 seconds by lap 28, but he also had Berger bearing down on him too, fresh from the winner's podium in Italy and scenting another one. Piquet pitted shortly afterwards with a clutch problem, was sent out again but retired on about half distance to give Lotus another fruitless afternoon, by which time Nannini had made his way up to 12th, which became 11th with Piquet's retirement. Soon just 3 seconds covered the top three on the track as Prost, Capelli and Berger traded fastest laps, but unbeknownst to anyone outside, Berger had a problem. He'd reached for the fuel mixture control, but accidentally set off his fire extinguisher instead, sending freezing gas all round the inside of the cockpit and numbing his legs. It began to thaw quickly enough in the heat, but turned to water, which got on the brake pedal, his foot slipped off, and he slid sideways into the gravel at turn 3 on lap 36. He got out and examined his shoe soles, but his race was run. Capelli was released from the pressure from behind while Senna regained third, with Mansell still behind him but unable to make any impression on the McLaren. Prost's own fuel gauge, meanwhile, was working just fine, and told him he could afford to push a bit, so he did, beginning to ease out over Capelli once more. So at the end of lap 37 of 70, Prost led Capelli by about 3 seconds, with Senna some 22 seconds back in third, with Mansell hot on his heels, then another 12 seconds back to Gugelmin in fifth and Alboreto sixth, with Boutsen, Warwick, Caffey and Nannini making up the top 10 and the last unlapped drivers. With Berger's disappearance, the cameras turned for entertainment to Senna and Mansell as they made their way through traffic, just in time for a tired Sir Nigel to lock up and nearly go off as they went past Lorini's Azzella. He was still very much up for it, though, rallying to have a go at Senna in a move that nearly took them both out and forced him to back off a little and have another go. The pair hadn't had chance for one of their real ding-dong battles so far this year, but this was turning into a classic, with Senna now in the red and white McLaren instead of the black and yellow Lotus. The Williams was faster into the corners, the McLaren was faster out of them, and the result was pure entertainment. Behind them and off-camera, Gugelmann was having problems with his clutch and started dropping back, with Alboreto and Bootsen moving up into 5th and 6th on lap 48. The number 27 Ferrari setting the fastest lap in the process, but still Mansell and Senna were going at it hammer and tongs, as the laps were now ticking down the last 20 to the end. Nannini came in for an impressive 9th with a major vibration problem. A change of tyres and a suspension check failed to fix it, so he came back in to retire. The cameras cut away from the Mansell-Senna battle just in time to miss Mansell getting it all wrong when lapping Jonathan Palmer, bouncing off the back of the McLaren without doing it any damage and sending himself into the barriers to the delight of the crowd. But they quickly stopped cheering when Senna immediately peeled into the pits for a precautionary pit stop, dropping to 6th as Mansell hobbled back to the pits. So Alboreto was now 3rd but in no danger of getting anywhere near Capelli as Gugelmann's clutch finally gave up on lap 60. Passing his teammate's smoking car finally persuaded Ivan to settle back and accept 2nd place rather than continuing to push for a win. So with 10 laps to go, it was Prost, Capelli, Alboreto, Boots and Warwick and Senna. The Belgian was having some kind of trouble dropping off Alboreto and with Warwick fast approaching. It wasn't going to be a photo finish up front, but things might get interesting in the lower points yet, and the Portuguese broadcasters obliged their neighbours with some nice shots of Luis Perez Sala running a very creditable 8th in the Minardi. Alain Prost cruised to his 33rd career win and his 5th of the year to retake the championship lead on points, with Ivan Capelli taking a magnificent and well-deserved 2nd place, the best result of his career by some margin. Alboreto, however, still without a drive for 1989, was once again the victim of the thirsty Ferrari engine, coasting across the line to finish, but not before Bootsen and Warwick had swept by to take 3rd and 4th places, thank you very much. At least he kept 5th, edging across the line as Senna rounded the last corner. Caffey spluttered home with a cracked exhaust to take a fine 7th, Sala was 8th, Strife an encouraging 9th for the troubled AGS team, and Arnoux 10th, his best finish of the year, with Tarquini and Lorini multiple laps adrift but also still going. All 3 drivers on the podium looked like they'd won, but after the race, Prost was very critical of Senna's manoeuvre in squeezing him almost into the pit wall at the end of lap 1. Quote, I knew I had to keep my foot down because at one stage we had our wheels interlocked. If I'd eased off, we could have caught wheels and then who knows what would have happened. If that's how he wants to win the championship, I'm not interested. I don't want any part of it, and yes, we will have words. Clearly, as the sharp end of the season approached, the camaraderie and friendly rivalry between the two was beginning to show strains, which could lead to fireworks in the last 3 races. There was just 7 days now until the next race at Jerez in Spain, and Ron Dennis would no doubt be attempting to soothe his drivers and get them to the end of the season.